It is true that over the last decade, artificial intelligence has been increasingly applied to our everyday lives. Artificial intelligence is the simulation of human intelligence processes by machines, especially computer systems. One of our trend predictions for 2023 has been Humanit-AI, where we predict that humans and machines will increasingly work closely with one another and continue to be integrated. A big indicator of this trend over the last few months has been the widespread use of ChatGPT, and in particular, the discussion of how it will change aspects of the education sector. So joining me today to chat about ChatGPT and the impact of AI on the education sector is Mike Abecina. Mike, welcome back to the podcast.
It's so great to be here, and it's great to chat with you about it, Ash.
It's always good to hear your perspective because you've got quite a big connection to the education sector. Could you just elaborate a bit on what your connection is to the education sector for our listeners?
Sure. Well, prior to becoming a data scientist, I worked in education as a mathematics teacher. I was also the head of maths for a number of years, then worked in the IT department in the data analytics space, and currently just, you know, in contact with a lot of educators, still thinking and dreaming about the next great education app I plan to build in the future. So yeah, very much have a foot in that area, so to speak.
Yeah, cool. That's awesome. And how did being a maths teacher eventuate into you becoming a data scientist?
Yeah, well, I guess maths and data science sort of overlap quite naturally, but it was, I guess, that interest in technology, that interest in wanting to learn something more. And I know that schools have tons of data and aren't probably utilizing it the best. And so I saw a real need there to upskill myself, learn some real technical tools and give back to the education sector for sure.
That's awesome. Yeah. I think a lot of people are pretty aware that McCrindle does a lot of research about and consultation to the education sector. We do a big sort of annual education study every year, and we are regularly asked to present and be involved with professional development days and even work closely one-on-one with certain schools across Australia and beyond and different associations. I feel like in the last few months, with schools going back for a new year, everyone has been talking about ChatGPT, and I know we've had a lot of conversations about it with you off mic. You've been following it very closely. For those who don't know, how would you describe what ChatGPT is?
So ChatGPT, I guess in the way that people use it, is a chatbot that's a really, I guess, intelligent chatbot that's able to pretty much answer what you ask it. What people don't realize is that underlying that is a very, I guess, complicated and intelligent language model that is able to do all sorts of tasks. Like it's able to summarize information for you. It's able to write text in a persona, write poetry. I'm using it at the moment to help debug code, and it's definitely a game changer for people in that space. What people don't realize, or I guess people are starting to realize in the education space, is that it's a great, how do you say it, like a co-pilot, if you like. Something or someone, if you allow me to sort of use that phrase, someone that is able to, I guess, assist you in your learning, whether it's learning a new topic, if you've got queries or questions about a particular idea, it's able to give you that information in a real sort of conversational way. And the fact that it's so large and it has, you know, such great memory means that it's able to maintain that conversation. So you're not having to repeat yourself. It remembers what, I guess, misunderstandings that you have in the past, in that conversation. So it sort of addresses you like it's a real conversational partner. And I think that that's the reason why it's had such an impact, is that people are only just realizing now that technology can converse with you in this manner.
Mm. Yeah, it's really interesting. I've had a little bit of a play around with it on your advice, and it was amazing. Like, I think maybe for me personally, I was like a little bit on the skeptical side maybe, or like, oh, what's this going to, you know, do? Like if it can write a blog post, does that replace that part of my role or whatever it might be? And then I had a play around with it and I was like, actually, it's kind of like it does the heavy lifting for some aspects. Like you could ask a question, it brings out some really great, you know, copy or content, then you can go in and shape it. But I wonder if that's where maybe educators are worrying about, I guess, the students maybe using it to do their work. Do you think that's a valid or a good summary of maybe why people are a little bit fearful of it, or what do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's so that aspect of heavy lifting, there is, I guess, this belief that if a student is presenting something as their own work, then from scratch, everything has to be thought of, spoken of, written from the perspective of the student. However, I guess that sort of perspective doesn't take into account the secondary sources that student interacts with, the conversations that they have. And so ChatGPT, if you like, is a more intelligent version of a secondary source. And so I'm not sure if people within the education sector fully appreciate that or fully agree with that, largely because this secondary source is trained on so many millions of artifacts, of which the authors of those artifacts are not recognized. And so I personally think it is a valid concern. However, the world is changing. And so we've got to, at one level, acknowledge that, okay, this is a concern, but also identify the great benefits of using this tool. And so because there is, if you like, an overlap there that hasn't been fully thought out and articulated, and hasn't been ingrained in the policies and procedures of the school yet. I can understand why there is both, you know, people who are excited about it, see the opportunities, and then people who are, yeah, not only skeptical, but worried for the future of education. I resonate. You get me on whatever day and I resonate with both sides, sometimes equally. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's really helpful, I think, to explore, the challenges and also the immense benefits. I mean, I feel like that's how I think about it in my sort of simplistic view of it impacting the future of education around how students complete particular assignments or tasks. Mm. Is that how you see it impacting the future of education as well?
I would say that we've got to first acknowledge that it's impacting the whole world before it's impacting education. So in the same way that, like, even just this morning, Google announced its competitor to ChatGPT called Bard AI, and it tried to do this sort of thing about James Webb Telescope and got information wrong. As a result, Google lost like $1 billion on the share market. So it's impacting the whole world. That we got to acknowledge that this is not isolated in education sort of thing. This is impacting workplaces. This is impacting Gen Alpha, who will grow up, you know, thinking that this technology is second nature. So I guess we've got to sort of look at it at that sphere. And to think about it as only impacting, say, assessment is, I guess, quite a narrow view, I think. It's going to impact lots of different areas. And I guess the extent to which it's going to impact it is going to, I guess, largely be based on how leaders, education leaders, approach it, how they police it, provide guardrails for it, and also, I guess, allow opportunities. So, yes, definitely assessment is an area. So, you know, detecting plagiarism. We're seeing at this point a real AI arms race between ChatGPT or OpenAI and OpenAI with itself. So it's actually built a model to detect whether something's been used by OpenAI. So they're very transparent about wanting to use it ethically. And then you've got Turnitin, who've built their own AI sort of ChatGPT detector. So definitely assessment isn't going anywhere, and the need to validate that the thing that's being submitted is the student's own work, whatever that means. And I guess that leads to the second one about standards. So it is going to impact the educational standard and what we mean by them. So at this point in time in 2023, if someone writes an essay, we can say, okay, that's a good essay, or we get ChatGPT to write a blog. Oh yeah, that's actually a reasonably intelligent blog. But the only reason why we can say those things is because we've been trained in an education system prior to ChatGPT. And so we have been given the skills to critically assess, to write, to listen, all those sorts of things. 5 or 10 years time, if these technologies become widespread, become, I guess, more utilized in everyday life, which I'm assuming will be happening, it's going to be harder for us to judge whether something is good or not, because the thing that taught us what was good was ChatGPT. So I think when it comes to educational standards, teachers and education systems going to be a lot more deliberate in, needing to, instill, well, what is actual quality, what is excellence in this domain. I know that in the HSC, Year 12 students have to do this module called All My Own Work. And All My Own Work is this module that sort of helps, students determine when something is plagiarism, when something is not. Well, you can sort of throw that stuff out the window now, because ChatGPT, that information hasn't been ingrained into that yet. And so, this is going back to the whole sort of policy sort of guardrail aspect of, we're going to need to become more educated in what these technologies can do, in order to be able to provide the best education for our students. Probably the last one that I'll mention, the largest, another impact, and this is a bit of a sad one, is it's a bit of a distraction. It's a bit of a distraction from other things that you and I have talked about in education that are still there, like low retention, low job satisfaction. Those things are still going to be there, whether ChatGPT comes and goes, and whether AI really enhances what we do. And so I'm just hoping that education leaders aren't distracted too much by this huge, if you call it, wave of enthusiasm, when there are still quite a few difficulty areas in education that need addressing.
I think it's really helpful advice for anyone who is a leader in a school or an education space to, be mindful that, yes, it's exciting conversations around ChatGPT, but, we shouldn't let that distract us too much from those other things that are really important. Mm. I think you've kind of elaborated on this a little bit already, but because it's just been interesting to hear your thoughts as you've observed conversations going on around the education sector and just kind of really seeing what people are thinking about this, and as it evolves and as we learn more and as the tool itself evolves, how the conversation is changing. Do you think that more people that you speak to and that you read about, their perspective on this, are they more embracing of it or fearful of it? Because I feel like my perception would have been that people are a bit nervous about it and skeptical. But then I was involved with a professional development day recently, and there's quite a bit of excitement around it from teachers, which I think pleased by, because it's so common and often that we just fear the things that we maybe don't understand. And this is all still so new. But what's your perspective on how you think the sector and people that you know within it are feeling about it at the moment?
Yeah, I think when I wrote about it sort of in the holidays, I had imagined that, education would be really polarized. And I think at the time it was, where you had these real strong advocates and real sort of strong critics to AI. I've actually seen it change, where you've got these people who are really enthusiastic about it, and then the people who were critical about it have sort of come to the middle, realizing that it's actually a bit of a non-event, that there are so many other things that are important in education, that this is just one thing, and they haven't got the time to really think about the implications for, what it means for the future of the profession and so on. So I'm seeing a great deal of enthusiasm, from teachers who have turned into prompt engineers overnight, who just know how to talk to, ChatGPT to get the best. And I think that's great. And they're sharing that information. But then you've got, as I was mentioning, people who are probably initially skeptical, who have just moved on to go, okay, it's a thing, and it might help in some areas, but there are more important things that I've got to focus on. I've got to focus on getting to know my students. I've got to focus on, organizing, teaching programs and that sort of thing. And to be honest, I think that's a great thing, because I think that that is the right attitude, that we can't, in education, the value of that institution is that relationship between teacher and student. And you don't want, the CEOs of big tech to drive the agenda of education all the time. So I think that's a great response, to be honest.
Yeah, that's really good to hear. As we think about ChatGPT, that's the kind of one of the moment. What opportunities do you see existing for people to make the most of ChatGPT, whether that be in the education sector or, like you mentioned, even beyond?
Yeah. I think it's good to remember our history a little bit. So when it comes to, I guess, education and the way in which we adopt technology into education, I think there has been a history of educators sort of throwing the baby out with the bathwater when it comes to a new sort of device or a new mode. So the one that I can think of most recently are smart boards. Smart boards were promised to be this thing that would revolutionize just the whole sort of didactic nature of education to be a lot more interactive. I think that failed to happen, and it's largely because we didn't really understand, I guess, the history of, well, why was that level of interaction important, to the point where now smart boards are sort of these underutilized uses of technology. ChatGPT has, generative AI has the potential for that sort of thing to happen again. And so it's really important for educators to go back a little bit and go, well, what are the really important things that we as educators have discussed that are important prior to ChatGPT coming along? I can think of one of the things that ChatGPT will be a great service to, and that's personalized education. So we've seen in education and in research how important it is to keep students engaged. And we know from research that teachers or students are a lot more engaged when the content is personalized in a way that's scaffolded, meets students with their current level of understanding so that it's easy for them to go from A to B rather than having to go from A to Z or whatever. ChatGPT can enhance that and can speed it up. I don't think anyone 6 months ago would have thought that personalized education would have come in the form of a chatbot. But it satisfies it. It does the things that I guess education researchers were wanting: scaffolded lessons, personalized learning, the ability for students to, respond where they are at. ChatGPT can do that. So I think that if, as long as we contextualize this tool in the concerns and I guess the opportunities that we wanted in education prior to ChatGPT coming along, it has the potential to have a great deal of impact. If I can sort of change tact a little bit and sort of talk in the more technical sort of IT side of things, I think when it comes to impact, the best way for any sort of system or any sort of, innovation to have impact is when it's at scale. And so what I mean by that is currently what you've got are people who are engaging with ChatGPT just by logging on to the website, talking to it, and that's sort of the end of the session. I think what IT departments in schools can be doing is starting to utilize the OpenAI API. So basically what an API is just a gateway for IT departments to sort of interact with OpenAI tools in a much more automated way. And so I think in the last sort of 5 to 10 years, there have been three pieces of, if you like, information that we've been wanting to connect together, and that is data, insights, and then communication. So in the last 5 or so years, schools have really, progressed quite well going from the data that they have. They've got tons of data to be able to get some insights. And the insights are usually through reports. Some schools are moving into dashboards, but we're not really at a stage yet to communicate that in a way that's, understandable, relevant to students. OpenAI's API allows us to do that, so that if we get those insights and somehow craft those insights into a prompt that we can feed into the API, then it can communicate it in a really nice sort of relevant way that teachers, students, parents will be able to understand, make action, act on. And so I think that if we can sort of train IT departments to use that API, get familiar with bringing OpenAI resources into their system, it'll certainly produce more of that scale. Microsoft have partnered with OpenAI. So it's actually going to appear a lot more in the sort of Microsoft products like Office, all the Microsoft products. So it's going to be easier for, it to have a scalable impact. So, yeah.
That's really interesting about the communication of the data and the insights and all of that speaking to each other. It's a kind of space, that we operate in as well at McCrindle and try and help educators do that. So it makes sense that that is an opportunity that you see, particularly, I guess, as a data scientist and helping. And a big part of your role here is as well to give advice to leaders around that data science and how they can utilize the data they have better. And I guess that leads me to my next question, which is, what advice do you have for, let's say, a strategic decision maker, or even, again, going back to the education sector, like a principal or a teacher or even a parent? So just anyone really in general about AI and education. What advice, further to even the comment you made in your last question, would you have about AI for them?
General principle would be, don't fight it, prepare for it. So it's going to be in, I mean, it already is in things that you are not aware of. Even when you go on Amazon and it somehow magically creates this amazing product recommendation for you, and you just decide, oh, I'm probably not going to buy that thing. That is 30% of Amazon's revenue through artificial intelligence, thinking of the right product to recommend to you. So it's everywhere. It's a case of us just being prepared for it. I think for organizations, as they're starting to incorporate AI and wondering whether it is something that they want to invest in further, as someone who has deployed artificial, so I've built and deployed artificial intelligence in various industries, in education and in corporate, as someone who's done that for 3 years, the same question, I guess the first question I still ask is, what value is this really going to bring? And you've got to really clarify that. I think that lots of people, when it comes to artificial intelligence, are sort of quite either scared or really excited, but can't articulate what it is that they're scared about and what it is that they're excited about. I think when it comes to businesses, you got to get past that, and you got to be able to go, well, what are the hard numbers and figures that, or, you know, the ways in which this is going to enhance, you know, people's jobs. And you got to, yeah, be able to articulate what that value actually is. And once you've identified what that value is, don't go too hard, too big. So one principle that we work with when it comes to deploying AI is that AI works best when it does simple things. It automates simple things that have minimal impact when they go wrong. So you don't necessarily want, you know, ChatGPT to suddenly rewrite all the principal's addresses to, you know, the college community, because you don't want to get that wrong. Rather, think about how could you use it to automate email replies, where it's just simply, you know, it's hard to get wrong, and it's still very effective and important that we do that. I would also say that, and this is something that I mentioned in last week's webinar that we did, that AI works best when there's a human in the loop. And I guess what I mean by human in the loop is that there is a human, A, supervising exactly what the artificial intelligence model is spitting out, providing guardrails in how to best practice in how to use it, what sort of tasks are just too complicated for AI to do. And it's interesting because the reason why I guess ChatGPT has become so successful and has been such a groundbreaking application is because there are humans in the loop. So in terms of the training of that model, they utilize a lot of human labelers for better or worse. You know, reports have come out about the way in which they're underpaid. So obviously that's an ethical concern that moving forward, but bringing humans into the loop allowed that thing to, I guess, know how humans respond and what sort of, you know, responses, I guess, most relevant to a particular question. So yeah, bringing humans in both the training and the deployment and the use of it, it's really important for organizations to succeed deploying AI.
Yeah, I think that's really sage and wise advice in terms of not being fearful of it and being prepared and embracing it in some ways. But then, like you said as well, having humans in the loop. And I think sometimes a really simplistic view I have of these sorts of things is, like, we think about those dystopic, you know, movies where they're like, when the robots overtake, and we kind of just jump ahead to that without thinking about all the steps that it would require to get to there. And we just fear that outcome, or that it's just going to replace all of our jobs as humans without actually having a more calculated response to it. And the fact that, I guess, maybe this is hopefully it's not naive or simplistic, but that even the people who are creating these bots or artificial intelligence are doing it so that we can save time in our day or take the repetitive tasks out, like they're doing it for human benefit, hopefully, is the goal here. And as long as, like you said, humans are involved, hopefully we can obviously guide and move that in an ethical way forward.
Mm. Definitely when it comes to artificial intelligence, it, like when you're talking about those dystopian sort of things, like I don't want to say that they are impossible. Like I just want to say that in order for us to not get there, it's more necessitates the, how do you say it, the intervention of humans, you know? And I think organizations like OpenAI is very open, if you like, to making sure that we don't get to a real dystopian novel.
good from them. Okay, Mike, putting your futurist hat on, what do you see as being next in the AI space? Is this the beginning of something new, do you think?
Yes, I think it is the beginning of something new. And when I say new, AI has been around for 50 years, but I guess it hasn't got this public attention, this immediate application that we're seeing. And as we speak, there is an AI race happening. So, you know, Google have just announced their bot. They've bought these other companies to help build it. So there is a real, if you like, race to build the next great AI application. And it's going to be a part of, our culture, I think. I think when it comes to schools anyway, schools will become more conversant with this technology, that we won't just be people who are users. I think more and more people in education will become builders, and it'll become easier to build this stuff. So in the future, I can imagine teachers, rather than just simply waiting for the next iteration of ChatGPT to be trained on the internet, what they can do is upload their own documents into a folder and chat to them, rather than, you know, having to mine through the documents and to go, what's the key bit of information, upload a whole bunch of documents that you know you need to learn very quickly and chat to them. What are the key topics here? How does this document relate to what I'm currently working on? And that will become easier. And when I say coming months, I really mean weeks. Like this sort of stuff is already starting to be developed. I think also we'll become more ethically conscious of how these models are being built. So as I alluded to earlier, ChatGPT or OpenAI's training of ChatGPT, Time magazine released an expose into the horrendous work conditions that these data labelers had to undergo in order to, I guess, provide the necessary data. And I think people are going to become more conscious of that, making sure that these models are carbon emission efficient, guided by, you know, strong ethical guidelines and how they are built. For education, though, and this is the one that sort of makes me, I guess, most hopeful, is it's going to bring more clarity to what it means to be a teacher. It's going to identify just how special teachers are, in that if you go to ChatGPT, it's you as the user have to prompt it to ask, you know, what do I need to know about this topic? A teacher, on the other hand, is motivated by enough sort of care and empathy and concern to initiate the conversation themselves. So it's meeting the unconcerned student where they are at. Hey, how's life going? Where are you up to with this project? Is there anything that I can do? ChatGPT, generative technologies don't have the care and empathy to do that. And so it's going to bring a lot more clarity to, I guess, why teachers are so valuable in the education industry, which I'm excited by.
Yeah, it's me too. It's really great to hear you talk about that and share about that. And you alluded to it earlier, but I do want to encourage everyone in the education sector and beyond who's listening to the conversation today to go and have a read of that article that you wrote, How ChatGPT Will Impact the Future of Education. And it's got some really helpful questions around the role of the teacher, like you just alluded to, and the role of technology and also the role of the assessment. So I think it's a really provocative article in terms of really gets us thinking critically about the use of AI and ChatGPT, and to be aware of those particular maybe challenges, but also the benefits that it is able to provide. Like you said, if we're able to guide it and use it in a helpful way for students, but like you've also mentioned, for teachers and for the processes that maybe they can, this sort of thing can help with, because you know firsthand, Mike, from your experience in the sector, and we know from our research that teachers are among some of the hardest working, I think, people in our nation and in our world particularly. So it's exciting, hopefully, for them too.
Yeah, absolutely.
So good to chat to you today, Mike, about ChatGPT. Thank you so much for your wisdom and expertise and keeping across this particular development of technology and your advice for the education sector. It's been fantastic having you on the podcast today.
Yep, love chatting with you, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, you can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com. And if you head to the articles section of our website, that's where you'll be able to find Mike's article about ChatGPT. So as always, thank you again for listening today, and bye for now.